Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum. I'm here today at the Royal Armouries National Firearms Centre in Leeds, England. And I'm here courtesy of Armament Research Services. And one of the things that ARRIES has been doing a fair amount of research and writing on are improvised and craft-produced firearms. So, while we were here at the NFC, we figured it would be really cool to take a look at one of the most publicized and famous improvised or craft-produced firearms, and that is the homemade 9mm submachine gun designed by Phillip A. Luty. Now, Mr. Luty was a British subject. He actually lived near here in Leeds, out in the country, and this was a project of his largely as a political statement, kind of to give the finger to the government about banning various types of firearms. His point was, it's impossible to try and ban firearms because you have to ban the knowledge of how they work, which you can't possibly do. And to prove his point, he decided to manufacture a gun using absolutely no firearms components. So if you're a viewer in the United States, what you're used to is the registered part of a gun being the receiver, which is different than how the laws typically work in most of Europe. In Europe, especially here in the United Kingdom, the controlled components of the gun are the ones that have to bear pressure. So parts like the bolt, the barrel, gas pistons, the parts that are actually technically usually the most difficult to manufacture are the ones that are controlled. What the receiver, which in the US would be controlled, is typically not really a controlled item in the UK. It's looked at, and this really kind of makes sense from an arms control perspective. The receiver doesn't matter. The important parts are the pressure-bearing ones. If you don't have pressure-bearing parts, you're not building a gun. And that is the take that Luty decided to attack by saying, I don't need controlled gun parts in order to make a gun. I can go down to the hardware store and buy everything that I need in order to make a fully functional 9mm submachine gun. That is precisely what he did. In fact, these are both Luty handmade guns. And then he went and published all of his plans and building instructions in a book called Expedient Homemade Firearms by P.A. Luty. And this wasn't, if he had decided to do this because he just wanted to go out in his backyard and play with a submachine gun from time to time, he probably would have been able to get away with it just by being discreet. But instead, for him, this was really a serious political statement, and he kind of made a name for himself and was very outspoken. The police knew quite well what was going on, and all they had to do was actually manage to catch him with pressure-bearing components of his firearm or ammunition, both of which were controlled at the time. And in 1998, they finally did. They caught him with a submachine gun when he was out doing some test firing and proceeded to try him for basically illegal firearms possession. And they won. Not surprisingly, this was a pretty open and shut case. In fact, it was this little submachine gun here specifically that he was caught with. Now, to his credit, these guns both look pretty darn crude. I mean, these things are put together with hex head machine screws and washers and various types of crude bent sheet metal. So in order to actually convict Luty, the government had to prove that this was a firearm, which is defined as a lethal barreled weapon. They had to prove all three of those points. So as part and parcel of this trial, the government loaded this thing up and test fired it to see if it was actually a functional firearm. And to Luty's credit, it was. I'm not sure that it ran perfectly, but it ran pretty close, which is really quite impressive given that it doesn't have any original firearms components, you know, factory-made repurposed gun parts, including the magazine. Even the magazine on this was handmade from steel and screws and wire springs, and he made it all himself, documented how, and actually did so successfully. Of course, one of the debate here goes back and forth between should free citizens have the right to make firearms, or should they not? And on the not side is typically concerned that, well, criminals and terrorists and various non-state actors will get their hands on these plans and use them to build guns when we don't want those people to have guns, obviously in places where they can't just freely buy them. And to the credit of that side of the argument, Luty-style guns have actually shown up worldwide with criminal and, I don't know about terrorist, but various types of very definitively criminal gangs. So it was, his publication did make the rounds, and these guns were manufactured by various rather unlikable groups. Of course, the counter argument to that is that's the price of having freedom, is that everybody gets it, and some people will misuse it. But is that necessarily a reason to prohibit everyone from having it? That is, of course, the basic argument, the fundamental argument of gun control. But we're not here to solve that question. We are here to take a closer look at these two interesting submachine guns. You can clearly see that this is put together with all random types of hardware store components. Hex head screws, cap nuts. The magazine release is a pair of washers on a spring and a bolt. So here's our magazine release. It is a piece of spring steel right there. And then the front of the magazine release was a nut that has been ground down at an angle. So you can even just push a magazine in and it will lock in place. The magazine here has this collar around it that acts to stop it at the proper insertion depth. You have witness holes on the magazine. It is pretty much a single stack magazine because double stack is a lot more difficult to manufacture. Very impressively, Luty actually manufactured the mags and the feed lips all himself, and they pretty much work. It's a simple magazine design. I would expect that he probably used a Sten gun mag as a model. The Sten is also a single feed magazine. But this is not a trivial task. A lot of people look at crudely made firearms and make all sorts of comments about how, well, I could, you know, anyone could build that in their garage. The truth of the matter is this sort of thing is a lot more difficult to do than you would think, especially to do and have it make work. And it's impressive when someone is able to pull it off. If we look at the construction here, you can see basically front and rear trunnions, or a front trunnion, attached with screws on all four sides. The barrel is non-rifled. It's just a hollow piece of appropriate size tubing. The bolt face, we have a bolt handle here. And the bolt face has a fixed firing pin in it. And it does fire from an open bolt, so it locks back like so. When I pull the trigger, bolt drops forward and fires. There's a rear end cap here that's just held on by a screw, and inside, the rear of the recoil spring is locked in place with these four screws. There is an upper and a lower assembly, a few very basic machining cuts here. You could build one of these things with a hacksaw, most likely. And of course, that was Luty's idea. It's a crude gun. It's a heavy gun. The trigger pull sucks. The accuracy would suck because it's a non-rifled barrel. It's not perfectly reliable, although it is mostly reliable. What this gun does is exactly what it was designed to do, which is to make the point that you really, truly cannot ban firearms without banning all metal. And today, that would even extend to polymer. There have been various polymer 3D printed adaptations of this gun, not fully plastic, but I'm sure people are working on that as we speak. It is truly the idea that being able to build weaponry, specifically firearms, is a matter of having the knowledge of how they work, and that's something that simply cannot be prohibited. I would really like to thank the National Firearms Center here in Leeds for allowing me to take a look at these two guns. They are obviously kind of politically touchy objects, but it's really cool that they have actually been preserved. Now, in part, that's because they're criminal evidence, but they are here and they are kept as part of the collection at the National Firearms Center. Also, of course, Ares made this trip possible, and if you're interested in craft-produced and expedient homemade firearms like this one, make sure to check Ares' website. There is a publication coming out that Ares had a large hand in writing on this exact subject, as well as high-resolution pictures of these two guns. Thanks for watching.